brothers and sisters to increase your iman. Read the miracle, recite the Qur'an. Recite it every day and do read it loud. The verses of Qur'an are all Muslim's pride. This miracle was revealed over a long time span. Sent from Allah to an angel, then to a man. That man was Muhammad, the best of creation.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Alhamdulillahi wa kafa wa salamun ala ibadihi alladhina astafa. La siyama al-Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallama tasliman kathira. Dear brothers and sisters, welcome to another live edition of our program, Correct Your Recitation. And I'd like to welcome our studio guests as well. Sheikh Hassan, thank you for joining us once again. Izzat, Ahmed, and Fahim, may Allah bless you all and accept from all of us. Allahumma ameen. Today, inshallah, we're going to begin another beautiful surah. All the surahs of the Quran are beautiful. It is all the word of Allah the Almighty. It is Surah Al-Fath, the great victory, the opening, or the conquest. Surah Al-Fath is the third chapter in the 26th part of the Quran. By the grace of Allah, we covered Surah Al-Ahqaf, and we covered and we finished last episode Surah Muhammad, peace be upon him. We're going to begin today, inshallah, with Surah Al-Fath. And remains for us afterward Surah Al-Hujurat, then Surah Qaf for the 26th part of the Quran. And Surah Al-Fath is a Madani Surah. We're going to learn all about when, where it was revealed, the general meaning and the connection between Surah Al-Fath and the previous Surah, Surah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and what did Allah deliver in the Surah and also its virtues. Soon after, we listen to the beautiful recitation according to the dialect of Hafs and Asim from Sheikh Hassan, inshallah. Please.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إنا فتحنا لك فتحا مبينا ليغفر لك الله ما تقدم من ذنبك وما تأخر ويتم نعمته عليك ويهديك صراطا مستقيما وينصرك الله نصرا عزيزا هو الذي أنزل السكينة في قلوب المؤمنين ليزدادوا إيمانا مع إيمانهم ولله جنود السماوات والأرض وكان الله عليما حكيما ليدخل المؤمنين والمؤمنات جنات تجري من تحتها الأنهار خالدين فيها ويكفر عنهم سيئاتهم وكان ذلك عند الله فوزا عظيما ويعذب المنافقين والمنافقات والمشركين والمشركات الظانين بالله ظن السوء عليهم دائرة السوء وغضب الله عليهم ولعنهم وأعد لهم جهنم وساءت مصيرا ولله جنود السماوات والأرض وكان الله عزيزا حكيما إنا أرسلناك شاهدا ومبشرا ونذيرا لتؤمنوا بالله ورسوله وتعزروه وتوقروه وتسبحوه بكرة وأصيلا
ما شاء الله بارك الله فيك. I guess according to another dialect you can recite, لِيُؤْمِنُوا بِاللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ وَيُعَزِّرُوهُ وَيُوَقِّرُوهُ وَيُسَبِّحُوهُ بُكْرَةً وَصِيلًا. Which dialect is it?
Ibn Kathir and Abu Amr.
Ibn Kathir and Abu Amr. So instead of addressing the second person, it is rather to the third person. So in case that you hear it, the Imam is reciting, لِيُؤْمِنُوا بِاللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ وَيُعَزِّرُوهُ. Instead of saying, لِتُؤْمِنُوا بِاللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ وَتُعَزِّرُوهُ وَتُوَقِّرُوهُ, we change the ta into ya to be addressing the third person instead of addressing the second person. And this is a dialect or a citation by Ibn Kathir. May Allah bless you, Sheikh Hassan. Zakallah khair. We'll come back to you, inshallah, when we examine this ayat and see if there is any different recitation according to different dialects, inshallah. Surat Al-Fath, the blessed surah, which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said when it was revealed, I just received a surah in one narration in the sound hadith. He said that to Anas ibn Malik radiyallahu anhu, yesterday in another narration, tonight I just received a surah. It is dearer to me than the whole earth and what is on top of it. Better and dearer to me than the whole earth and what is on top of it. Surat Al-Fath. Because it delivered several glad tidings. Not just one or two or three, many. It would be very interesting to learn what kind of glad tiding that Allah the Almighty delivered to His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam and obviously to the rest of the Ummah. Surah Al-Fath is a Madani Surah. Madani, which means was revealed either in Medina or after the migration. Because according to the science of the Qur'an, they categorize the Qur'an into either Makki or Madani based on either the time or the place. So those who consider the place of the revelation, anything which was revealed in Mecca or nearer to Mecca, then it is called Makki. Makki Quran was revealed in Meccan era. Anything of the Quran was revealed in Medina is considered Madani. But there is another school which says that if any Qur'an was revealed before the migration, even if it was revealed, like the Qur'an was revealed on the way from At-Ta'if, it was not in Mecca. You know, At-Ta'if is 60 miles away from Mecca. So that is Makki. And any Qur'an, any ayat, or any chapters were revealed after the migration, after the Prophet ﷺ set out migrating from Mecca, it is called Madani Qur'an. Madanian. It was revealed according to the era, not the area. Surat Al-Fath was revealed on the sixth year of the migration. So 6 years after the migration of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So according to the second school, which is a prominent opinion and the more right view, then automatically this Quran is Madani. And the place is a little different because Surat Al-Fath was revealed between Mecca and Al-Madina, maybe closer to Mecca. Okay, according to the second school of thought, which is a more right view, that any Quran was revealed after the migration is Madani. Even if it was revealed in Mecca, how would it be revealed in Mecca after the migration? Yes, of course, because during the Treaty of Al-Hudaybiyah, Quran was revealed. Umrat al-Qadha, Quran was revealed. And after and during the conquest of Mecca, Quran was revealed in Mecca. But it is called Madani, because this classification depends on the timing, not the geographical revelation of the Quran. So Surah Al-Fath accordingly is a Madani Surah. It was revealed when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam sat out from Al-Hudaybiyah and he was returning to Al-Madinah, so in between Mecca and Al-Madinah. But we say it's a Madani Surah. Its order in the Quran is chapter number 48. And Surat Al-Fath, the opening or the great victory or the great conquest, consists of 29 ayat, plural of ayah. 29 ayat. In order to understand the concept of Surat Al-Fath and why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam considered it the greatest bishara, the greatest glad tiding, and it is better for him than the whole world and what it contains, We have to understand that when the 6 year and after the battle of the trench, when the Meccans and the Confederates, Ghatafan, and their allies of the Yahud, the Jews of Bani Qurayza, they failed to harm Muslims, and Allah saved them during the battle of Al-Khandaq, the trench, or the Confederates. Afterward, and on the 6th year, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saw ru'ya, night vision, which he shared with his companions, that he was performing Umrah. Umrah? And you dress up in Ihram and you go to Mecca. Right away, the companions were very optimistic and they considered this is the best news. Why? Because to return back to Mecca and to be capable to perform Umrah, that's a sign of victory. But how? But they trusted Allah and His Messenger so much. So he said, whoever would like to join me to perform Umrah, let's go. 1400 companions joined the Prophet ﷺ, and amongst his wives, Ummu Salama, may Allah be pleased with her, joined the Prophet ﷺ. And if you're going to perform Umrah or Hajj, this is a very great act of worship, great virtues of rituals of ibadah. So the companions were not armed, only carrying their personal weapons, such as the swords in the sheath, to defend themselves on the way. We're talking about 400 miles, traveling on foot or on the back of their camels or their horses. So they declare that they are not going to fight by carrying the swords in the sheath. And they dressed up in Ihram and they assume the intention of Ihram from Dil Hulaifa. This is all a declaration of a peaceful trip to perform Umrah. But when they reach close to Mecca, Asafan, or an area which is known as Al-Hudaybiyah, the Meccans announced that we're not going to let these guys enter Mecca under any circumstances on our dead bodies. Are you out of your mind? You want to just enter Mecca and humiliate us and perform Umrah and go home freely and safe? It's not going to happen. The Prophet ﷺ started a series of negotiation back and forth. They sent representatives, and the Prophet ﷺ sent Uthman ibn Affan, may Allah be pleased with him, to negotiate with the Meccans, to visit with the Meccan chiefs and to tell them that we're here just to perform Umrah, perform Umrah and hit back. But the Meccans did something very tricky. They withheld Uthman ibn Affan, and they spread the rumor that Uthman was killed to aggravate Muslims and to see what is the worst that they can do. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, upon hearing this information, started taking a bay'ah. He sat beneath a tree and he set his back against it, and the companions, the 1400 of them, started coming to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam one after another, giving him the pledge of allegiance. What allegiance? What pledge? To fight back, to take revenge for the blood of Uthman ibn Affan. So initially they came to perform Umrah. They are in Ihram, and in Ihram you're not allowed to fight, you're not allowed to say a bad word, you're not allowed, to even to push a person. But you're allowed to defend yourself. You're definitely allowed to defend yourself. Uthman was declared as he was killed. And this is what the Meccans deliberately did. So the Prophet ﷺ started accepting the Pledge of Allegiance. And when they all did, also in Surat Al-Fath, Allah the Almighty delivered such a great good news to those companions who gave the Prophet ﷺ the bay'ah beneath the tree. Ayah number 18, Allah the Almighty says, لَقَدْ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ إِذْ يُبَايِعُونَكَ تَحْتَ الشَّجَرَةِ فَعَلِمَ مَا فِي قُلُوبِهِمْ فَأَنزَلَ السَّكِينَةَ عَلَيْهِمْ وَأَثَابَهُمْ فَتْحًا قَرِيبًا. Right in the midst of this dilemma, the Prophet ﷺ delivers the bishara. Those who gave the Prophet ﷺ the pledge of allegiance to fight back, to defend themselves, and to take revenge for Uthman's blood, Allah is pleased with them. What does it mean? Khalas, it's over. Once Allah is pleased with somebody, this is all what we want. You're saved. You're saved. رضي الله عنهم ورضوا عنه. Allah is pleased with them. So it was such a good news. But when the Meccans heard what the Muslims did, that these guys are not ordinary people, they tried them in the battle of Badr. They tried them in the battle of the trench. And they know that they are very powerful fighters. They fight for their faith. So they didn't want to take a chance. They didn't want to be slain in their own home. Each battle was like several hundred miles away from Mecca, but now this is going to be in Mecca. In case anything may happen, we're going to lose our ground. So the Meccan chiefs hurriedly sent Sahl ibn Amr in order to negotiate with the Prophet ﷺ a peace truce. And they announced that Uthman is safe and he's returning back. In fact, not only that Uthman ibn Affan was safe, no. Uthman ibn Affan also was offered to perform Umrah. They said, yeah, Uthman, you're an honorable person. You're most welcome to perform Umrah. What would you do if you were in Uthman's position? He said, no, I'm not going to perform Umrah by myself. I'm here to perform Umrah along with the Prophet and all our companions. If you guys are very sincere in your intention and you really resorting for peace, why don't you let us just perform Umrah and go home? He said, no, you may perform Umrah by yourself. So he refused. He said, I belong to this Ummah. We move as a group. We act as a group. I do not act individually. Very important lesson we learn from Uthman's behavior in this regard. So Uthman was released, and the Prophet ﷺ started the negotiation with Suhail ibn Amr, and they concluded what is known as the Treaty of Al-Hudaybiyah. All the articles of the Treaty of Al-Hudaybiyah and the terms were unfair to Muslims. Any person would read those terms would think that was crazy. And how did the Prophet accept that? As a matter of fact, not only readers of today's time, but the companions of the Prophet ﷺ, whom Allah said, لَقَدْ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. Allah is pleased with those believers who gave you the pledge beneath the tree, تحت الشجرة. But those companions couldn't understand why would the Prophet ﷺ accept such deal. It was completely unfair. The first term that Muslims are not going to perform Umrah this year, they have to return back. Okay, when are we going to perform Umrah? You come back next year and you stay only for 3 days to perform your Umrah. That was called later on, Sheikh Hassan, Umratul Qada, the makeup Umrah. The companions objected and they said, Ya Rasulallah, we're dressed up in Ihram and we brought our sacrifice. How are we going to do our Umrah? He said, don't worry about it. Let's go ahead and do tahallul. Slaughter our sacrifice and do tahallul. Shave our heads and go home. None of the companions agreed or accepted. The Prophet ﷺ entered his tent and he was very angry. And he was also worried about the companions because he was worried that they will face the same fate of Bani Israel when they objected to their Prophet Musa ﷺ. Ummu Salama, the wise woman, may Allah be pleased with her, said, Ya Rasulallah, calm down, take it easy on yourself. If you want them to follow you, when he kept saying, Halak al-qawm, halak al-qawm, they will be destroyed, they disobeyed me, they disobeyed Allah. So she said, Ya Rasulallah, just step out and order the barber to give you a haircut. You're going to see what's going to happen. When he stepped out, and he got a haircut, the companion saw that the Prophet ﷺ was serious about the tahallul and returning home. So they all rushed to do the same. And they all did tahallul before any of them would delay, then will be punished. That was a very unfair term, according to what the companions and us would think. But Allah the Almighty always says, وَعَسَىٰ أَن تَكْرَهُ شَيْئًا وَهُوَ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ. It may be that you dislike something while it is good for you. And the opposite is also true. It may be that you like something while it is bad for you. وَاللَّهُ يَعْلَمُ وَأَنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. Allah knows and you know not. وَاللَّهُ يَعْلَمُ وَأَنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. The second term, the main article of the treaty, which was 10 years of ceasefire, not to fight, for 10 years. And whoever wants to be allies with Muslims, they may choose so. We have to conclude that in the contract. And similarly, whoever wants to be allies with the... There is another term which was very ridiculous. That if anyone from Mecca wanted to accept Islam, is not allowed. If anyone from Mecca wanted to migrate, even if he managed to escape from Mecca and made it to Al-Madina, it is Muhammad's duty not to accept them, rather to return them back to Mecca. To be tortured? Yes. To be jailed? Maybe to be killed. That was a term. And the Prophet ﷺ agreed. And guess what, Ahmed? If you think this is ridiculous, Listen to this another time. If any Muslim supposedly decided to change his or her mind and apostate, become kuffar, and return to Mecca, Muslims should not prevent them from doing so. Wow. This is crazy. And so on and so forth. But yet the Prophet ﷺ agreed to all of that. When the companions argued with the Prophet ﷺ and said, Ya Rasulallah, didn't you promise us that we're coming to perform Umrah and you said you saw a night vision and all of that? He said, yes indeed. But did I tell you we're going to perform it this year? Huh? No, I didn't. I said we will perform Umrah, but not necessarily in this trip. Allah has a better plan for us. Even Umar ibn al-Khattab, may Allah be pleased with him, objected to that. But he couldn't openly object before the Prophet ﷺ out of love and respect. So he had a talk with Abu Bakr al-Siddiq, who was the only companion who was so steadfast. Whatever the Prophet ﷺ decides, he's agreeing 100%. No argument, no discussion, no second thought. So he kept asking him, isn't he the Prophet of Allah? Aren't they the kuffar? Doesn't Allah tell him what to do? So why we humiliate ourselves in such way? We're here to fight. We're here to perform jihad. And we can take them down. Abu Bakr al-Siddiq says to Umar al-Khattab, Ya Umar, he's a messenger of Allah. Ilzam gharza. Stick to what he says. He knows better. Look at the tranquility and the calmness. How much trust and confidence that Abu Bakr al-Siddiq radiyallahu anhu have in the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Subhanallah. So on the way back, all the companions were overwhelmed, were upset. Many things happened that they were very tired. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, let's go sleep and rest. And he said, who's going to wake up for Fajr? So Bilal ibn Rabah said, I will, Ya Rasulallah. You guys go to sleep. And inshallah, I'll wake you for Fajr. Everybody went to sleep. They were so tired and exhausted. Then Bilal ibn Rabah himself fell asleep. And only it was the sunrise, the sun rays, which awakened the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the companions started, you know, negotiating and talking. They thought this is like a bad omen. Even Fajr prayer we missed. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, calm down. مَنْ نَامَ عَنْ صَلَاتٍ أَوْ نَسِيَهَا فَلْيُصَلِّهَا مَتَى ذَكَرَهَا. You know, if you oversleep or forget about the prayer, just simply whenever you remember it, make it up. So call adhan, pray the sunnah, call iqama, and he led them in Fajr prayer after sunrise. No one is blameworthy because we simply overslept. Unlike the answer of Bilal ibn Rabah when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Ya Bilal, why didn't you wake us up? Didn't you say you're going to stay up to wake us up? He said, Ya Rasulallah, asabani ma asabakum. You guys were tired and you overslept. I too overslept. You know, I was tired. The Prophet ﷺ took it easy on his companions. And Allah descended as sakina upon the hearts of the believers, as the fourth ayah of the Qur'an, of Surat Al-Fath, talks about it. Anyway, they returned. And on the way, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the surah to the Prophet ﷺ from beginning to end. Some chapters, as Sheikh Hassan may tell us better, are not revealed entirely. You know, some verses are revealed as one segment, and some other verses. Then Jibreel alayhi salam would come to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and say, put these verses in this chapter, and this is like one chapter. So many chapters are like that. But Surah Al-Fath was revealed entirely from beginning to end, on the way from Mecca to Al-Madina. You know what, Izzat? It just reminds me with the incident when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was, he was a fugitive, fleeing from Mecca and hiding and traveling at night. Then Suraqa ibn Malik managed to chase them, spotted them, and he was so close to them, Ahmad. He was about to capture the Prophet and Abu Bakr, his best friend. Then the Prophet ﷺ says to Suraqa, Ya Suraqa, if you change your mind and you go home, I promise you that one day we'll give you the two bracelets of Kisra. Who's promising whom? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is escaping and is hiding, and there is a bounty over his head, 100 camels each. A bounty over his head. Everybody is looking for him and for his friend, alive or dead. And there he tells Suraqa, Don't worry about the 100 camels. You'll get better than that. Just go home. وَخَذِّلْ عَنَّا. Whenever you know that people are coming to chase us, tell them that, oh, they're not in this direction. Tell them to search in another direction. If you do that, you will get the two bracelets of whom? Not Al-Najashi, the Abyssinian king. Not of Abu Sufyan or Abu Jah. Of Kisra. Kisra, the Persian emperor. Yeah. Perhaps Suraq ibn Malik at this time did not think that would ever happen. He said, yeah, this man maybe is, you know, is a righteous man, is a good man, but this is not true. This is not going to happen. No way. Anyway, he returned not because of the promise, but because his horse sank in the sand a couple of times. So the Prophet ﷺ asked Allah to let him go, and he returned. Years later, during the era of the Khilafah of Umar ibn Khattab, may Allah be pleased with him, they conquered Persia. In the battle of Al-Qadisiyah, under the leadership of Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas, and the companions of the Prophet ﷺ collected all the gold and the jewelry of Kisra from the White Palace. And they brought it all before Umar ibn Khattab, radiyallahu anhu, in Medina. Everything. They did not miss a thing. No one was hiding a ring or a bracelet or a necklace. We're not interested in the dunya. Umar ibn Khattab was very happy that this has happened. And the amana and the honesty of the companions of the Prophet ﷺ, nothing is missing. Then there came Suraq ibn Malik and said, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, these two bracelets are mine.
So funny.
When was he promised to collect these two bracelets? You know, in the weakest time of this ummah, when the ummah was in its weakest condition, weakest from your perspective, but this ummah ever since it was born is powerful. In tansurullah yansurkum wa yuthabbit aqdamakum. So while the Prophet ﷺ was returning and all the companions except for a couple were very disappointed that they came to perform umrah and they didn't, what are they going to say to people when they return home and all of that? Allah did not entertain them by saying, don't worry, your umrah have been accepted and your word have been confirmed and all of that. No. He said, Inna fatahna laka fatham mubina. Indeed, most surely, we've given you a great victory, a manifest victory, not just any fatah. What kind of fatah? You think this is fatah? We're not able to perform umrah and you call it fatah? Yes, indeed. We have given you, O Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, a manifest victory. Not only that, listen to the next bishara. لِيَغْفِرَ لَكَ اللَّهُ مَا excuse me. لِيَغْفِرَ لَكَ اللَّهُ مَا تَقَدَّمَ مِنْ ذَنْبِكَ وَمَا تَأَخَّرَ وَيُتِمَّ نِعْمَتَهُ عَلَيْكَ وَيَهْدِيَكَ صِرَاطًا مُسْتَقِيمًا. الله أكبر. How many bishara? Forgiveness, perfecting his favor upon him, guiding him to a straight path, and before that, the manifest victory. All of that? Yes. لِيَغْفِرَ لَكَ مَا تَقَدَّمَ مِنْ ذَنْبِكَ وَمَا تَأَخَّرَ. لِيَغْفِرَ لَكَ اللَّهُ مَا تَقَدَّمَ مِنْ ذَنْبِكَ وَمَا تَأَخَّرَ. We know that Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم was infallible. الأنبياء معصومون. They wouldn't commit sins. So what forgiveness for? When I forgive you, is I forgive you whenever you do something bad and out of generosity and mercy, I pardon you and I forgive you. But can you call a sin that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم did? Well, حسنات الأبرار سيئات المقربين. It is perceived as a sin because this Prophet, who is very pure and infallible, whenever he had two choices and he chooses the lesser option, he perceives this as if it is a sin. Did the Prophet ﷺ commit a sin when he paid attention to the Meccan chiefs, when he was giving them da'wah, when Abdullah ibn Maktum came and he inquired about Islam and the Prophet ﷺ had frowned face before him? Initially, he started the conversation with these guys and he came to inquire while he was involved in this conversation. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blamed him for that. It is not befitting for you to do that. عَبَسَ وَتَوَلَّ أَنْ جَاءَهُ الْأَعْمَى وَمَا يُدْرِيكَ لَعَلَّهُ يَزَّكَّ. When the Prophet ﷺ said, I'm not going to eat honey anymore of this particular type, Allah the Almighty revealed, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّبِيُّ لِمَ تُحَرِّمُ مَا أَحَلَّ اللَّهُ لَكَ تَبْتَغِي مَرْضَاتَ أَزْوَاجِكَ وَاللَّهُ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. We've forgiven you for that. If you or I or any person did that, it is not a sin. It is not a sin. But from a Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it is not befitting. So that is the meaning of... There is a very interesting observation in the first ayah. All of you guys, you've been studying Arabic fahim, right? Fatahna. I said fatahna means from fatah, which is opening, victory, or conquest. Sah? Fatahna. Fataha. In which tense? Present, past, future?
In the past.
Past tense. It is past tense. Fatahna. And the na for the royal we. We have indeed given you a manifest, given you, it's a past tense. But this Bishara was delivered 2 years before the actual conquest of Mecca, right? But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala delivered it in the past tense. This is not an error. This is not a grammatical error. This is rather another confirmation and another glad tiding. Consider it done. It's over. We have indeed given you a great victory. It is recorded. It is going to happen. Khalas. It will be executed. It's like when you visit somebody who is sick and you want to assure him that he will be okay. You say, you're fine, you're just fine, you're okay. But he's not okay. You're being optimistic and you're saying, I hope that you'll be okay. But just to make it seem to him like he's going to be okay, you tell him, you're already okay. You're fine. But he is not. So in this case, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Inna fatahna, we have already given you. Nothing will stop it. This is similar to when Allah the Almighty described the believer's attitude whenever a command of Allah is revealed to the Prophet. Then he transmits and communicates this command to them. They do not double think about it. They do not negotiate. They do not ask questions. إِنَّمَا كَانَ قَوْلَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ إِذَا دُعُوا إِلَى اللَّهِ رَسُولِهِ أَنْ يَقُولُوا سَمِعْنَا is a past tense. أَطَعْنَا is a past tense. Maybe سَمِعْنَا we just heard, but أَطَعْنَا you need to this in the future, like we will obey. No. وَأَطَعْنَا done. Consider it done. There are a lot of very interesting informations about the revelation of Surah Al-Fath, inshallah. But we ran out of time for this segment. Inshallah, we'll continue in the next episode. Now we're going to take a short break, and inshallah we'll be back in a couple of minutes. Please stay tuned.
Recite it every day and do read it loud.
Huda TV is pleased to announce the launching of its first mobile phone application on all iOS and Android-based devices. Browse your phone store for our new app under the name of Huda TV. Huda app delivers a bunch of amazing and versatile services to our fans and viewers worldwide. You can watch our live streaming on the move, surf our large archive of categorized articles, benefit from our daily supplications, Askar, that every Muslim should recite throughout the day. Just tap on any item of the Askar list and it will take you to the specific supplication it indicates too. Need to know the broadcast time of your favorite program? Just click to broadcast schedule for specific details. Huda app allows users to browse the gems of Huda TV website, where they can enjoy our telemedia services by watching thousands of video clips, plenty of audio clips featuring invocations, nasheeds, and audio themes of our favorite programs. Go back to the index page and check upon what is going on at Huda TV by visiting ever-updated Huda News. Get to know the profiles of Huda stars and never forget to tap on our Behind the Scenes button for exploring our backstage activities. It's also worthy to check upon Huda's pages on social media websites and enjoy our awesome posts and sharing. Download Huda TV's app now and live our world of authentic Islamically themed educational knowledge. Huda TV brings light to every smartphone.
Welcome to Cosmic Proof, the one and only program that leads you to the truth wherever it is. For my sake,
and you're safe.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and welcome back. In this segment, we're going to start taking your phone calls for those who would like to recite this ayat with us today from the beginning of Surat Al-Fath through ayah number 9, the first page of Surat Al-Fath, chapter number 48. While waiting for your calls, inshallah, we'll begin with some of our studio guests. Unlike the usual routine, we'll begin normally from right to left, but this time I want Fahim to begin. So we're going to skip the order. Please, Fahim.
A'udhu billahi minash shaytanir rajim. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Inna fatahna laka fathan mubina. ليغفر لك الله ما تقدم من ذنبك وما تأخر ويتم نعمته عليك ويهديك صراطا مستقيما وينصرك الله نصرا عزيزا وينصرك الله نصرا عزيزا هو الذي أنزل السكينة في قلوب المؤمنين ليزدادوا إيمانا مع إيمانهم ولله جنود السماوات والأرض وكان الله عليما حكيما ليدخل المؤمنين والمؤمنات جنات تجري من تحتها الأنهار خالدين فيها ويكفر عنهم سيئاتهم
تجري من تحتها الأنهار
الأنهار خالدين فيها ويكفر عنهم سيئاتهم وكان ذلك عند الله فوزا عظيما ويعذب المنافقين والمنافقات والمشركين والمشركات الظانين بالله ظن السوء عليهم دائرة السوء وغضب الله عليهم ولعنهم وأعد لهم جهنم وساءت مصيرا ولله جنود السماوات والأرض وكان الله عزيزا حكيما إنا أرسلناك شاهدا ومبشرا ونذيرا لتؤمنوا بالله ورسوله وتعزروه وتوقروه وتسبحوه بكرة وأصيلا
حسبك بارك الله فيك جزاك الله خيرا عزتنا would you please begin
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إنا فتحنا لك فتحا مبينا ليغفر لك الله ما تقدم من ذنبك وما تأخر ويتم نعمته عليك ويهديك صراطا مستقيما وينصرك الله نصرا عزيزا هو الذي أنزل السكينة في قلوب المؤمنين ليزدادوا إيمانا مع إيمانهم ولله جنود السماوات والأرض وكان الله عليما حكيما ليدخل المؤمنين والمؤمنات جنات تجري من تحتها الأنهار خالدين فيها ويكفر عنهم سيئاتهم وكان ذلك عند الله فوزا عظيما ويعذب المنافقين والمنافقات والمشركين والمشركات الظانين بالله والمشركين والمشركات الظانين بالله ظن السوء عليهم وساءت مصيرا ولله جنود السماوات والأرض وكان الله عزيزا حكيما إنا أرسلناك شاهدا ومبشرا ونذيرا لتؤمنوا
حسبك بارك الله فيك شيخ حسن may I request you to recite maybe half of it according to us جزاك الله خير
from the beginning
yes from the beginning
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إنا فتحنا لك فتحا مبينا ليغفر لك الله ما تقدم من ذنبك وما تأخر ويتم نعمته عليك ويهديك صراطا مستقيما وينصرك الله نصرا عزيزا هو الذي أنزل السكينة في قلوب المؤمنين ليزدادوا إيمانا مع إيمانهم ولله جنود السماوات والأرض وكان الله عليما حكيما ليدخل المؤمنين والمؤمنات جنات تجري من تحتها الأنهار خالدين فيها ويكفر عنهم سيئاتهم وكان ذلك عند الله فوزا عظيما ويعذب المنافقين والمنافقات والمشركين والمشركات الظانين بالله ظن السوء عليهم دائرة السوء وغضب الله عليهم ولعنهم وأعد لهم جهنم وساءت بصيرا ولله جنود السماوات والأرض وكان الله عزيزا حكيما إنا أرسلناك شاهدا ومبشرا ونذيرا لتؤمنوا بالله ورسوله وتعزروه وتوقروه وتسبحوه بكرة وأصيلا.
إن شاء الله. May I request you also to recite the last two ayahs, 8 and 9, according to Ibn Kathir.
إنا أرسلناك شاهدا ومبشرا ونذيرا ليؤمنوا بالله ورسوله ويعزروه ويوقروه ويسبحوه بكرة وأصيلا.
الله عليك حسبك بارك الله فيك شيخ حسن and all of you. Thank you so much for joining us, brothers and sisters. May Allah bless you all. Thank you so much. And until next week, I leave you all in the care of Allah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Brothers and sisters, to increase your iman, read the miracle, recite the Quran. Recite it every day and do read it loud. The verses of Quran are all Muslims' pride. This miracle was revealed over a long time span. Sent from Allah to an angel, then to a man. That man was Muhammad, the best of creation. We were chosen to be part of his nation. He gave us a message, and that was Islam. So read this miracle, recite the Quran.